Hello students, as you all know that your test has been started and in physics, current electricity will be asked in the upcoming test. So children, start preparing for current electricity. If there is any doubt in any term, you can take my number from your class teacher and start giving response regarding the chapter. Your response will help us to break this one-way communication. Just listening to the video and my messages, it's feel like it is a one-way communication. So children, your messages, your doubts will be create a good, will help us in overcoming the gap which is there, which I really feel it is there. So it is your response only which can fill up the gap. Now, as you can see that today's topic is laws of motion. So after current electricity, the next chapter we are going to start with laws of motion. All of you take out your book and get ready with your pencil to underline the important points from the book. All of you come to the page number 56. Now on this page number, the topic is effect of force. Now children, because we are going to study about the laws of motion and we know that one of the effect of force is to change the speed, direction or even the state of the object. So first we have to understand the term force, because it is the physical quantity which is responsible to bring the objects into motion. Yes? So let us start with effect of force. We all know that force is a physical quantity which, you know, in a very basic language we say that it is a push or the pull exerted on the object. But what changes are seen when the force is exerted on an object? Consider a situation where you are playing with a football. What happened to the football when you kick the football? When I say kick the football, means you are applying the force. Yes? On applying the force, what happened to the football? Either you change the direction or you change the speed of the football. Yes? Or if the football is at rest, you bring it into the motion, or if the football is moving, you try to stop it. Yes? So you can change the state of the object. So it is seen from many examples that whenever the force is applied on the object, either it can change the state of rest or motion of the object. Yes? Or it can change the size or shape of the object. When I say size or shape of the object, let us take an example for this effect. For example, you are playing with the clay. Yes, when you play with the clay, what happened? You, on applying the force on the clay, the shape and the size of the clay changes. Or consider a spring in your hand. And you are stretching and compressing the spring. What happened on applying the force on the spring? Yes, its shape and size changes. Yes, so these are the two main effects of force. So the like I have underlined in my book, I want each one of you to underline this. The first effect is changing the state of rest or motion of the object. Yes. Means it can produce motion in the body. The example here for this is a fielder on the ground stops a moving ball by applying force with his hand. Yes, this example is also answer to question number 8 A part. So I hope you are underlining it and you will save your time by doing this. Next example will be the answer to question number 8 B. What is the example? When the force is applied on the pedal by a cyclist, what happens? it starts moving. So these are the two different examples. In one example, the force is stopping the object. Yes. In another example, the force is making the object to move. Yes. Now let us come to the next topic. Next point is, it can change the size or shape of the body. Just now we have taken the example of a spring where you apply the force on the spring, its shape and size changes. Yes. One more example given in the book is, by loading a spring hanging from a rigid support, the length of the spring increases. That will be the answer to question number 8C. See children, whatever effects are there, you should learn the example for every effect. Yes, you might be asked in the exam, give us an example where the force can change the shape of the object, or give us an example where force can make the object to come to rest, or it makes the object to change its speed. Yes, so you should think about the examples while reading this topic. Now let us move on to the next page, that is 57 page number. On this page, there is a note regarding the force acting on the rigid objects and non-rigid objects. Children, there are two types of object which you have studied in previous class also. Yes, this pen is considered a rigid object because when I apply force on it, the whole body together moves in one direction. Yes, so such objects are called as rigid objects. So in the rigid object, the change in interspacing between the constituent particles does not happen. Means there is no change occur in the particles of this rigid object when the force is acting on it. Or you can say there is no change in the dimension of the object, but cause only the motion in it. Means when I apply force on this object, only the position changes, or you can say it comes into motion, but no change in the shape has been observed. So such objects are rigid objects. Now instead of this pen, for example, I have a water balloon which is half filled with water. Yes, say I have a balloon here. What happened to the balloon if I apply force? You will observe that some portion will try to, you know, roll down to one side, or another portion of the balloon will try to move in a different way. So change in shape occurs. So you can call that as a non-rigid object. So in a non-rigid object, you know, all the particles of the object, they don't move in the one direction. Yes. So it causes change in its dimension. Yes, although it produces motion in the object, but it changes the shape of the object. So if I apply force on the object, and you found that with that force, the some kind of, you know, distortion occur in the object, and the particles are moving in this direction, some particles are moving in another direction. So that object is considered as non-rigid object. Now this is the answer to question number 7, first part. Yes, where you have to talk about the object, what happened to the object when force acting on it. Yes, so we have just now concluded that on the rigid body, when the force is applied, they come in motion, but no change in the dimension or the shape or size occur. But in the case of non-rigid object, what happened when the force is applied? When force is acting on non-rigid object, it comes into motion, along with that change in its dimension, that is shape or size occur. I hope the difference is clear to you, children. If you are not able to, you know, grasp the point in one go, you should rewind the video. If I will repeat the same point or rephrase my statements again and again, the you know, duration of the video will extend. So the best option is to rewind the video. And still, if there is any doubt in your mind, you must share it with me. Now next is, let us underline this. This is the definition for force. A force is that physical cause or physical quantity which changes or tends to change either the size, shape or state of rest or motion of the object, or you can say direction also. Force can even change the direction. Yes. So I hope all these important points are underlined and you will learn them. Yes. I am giving a document along with this video. In that document, there are notes and questions to think about, or you can say those are questions which I have, you know, framed from each paragraph. In between questions, you can say extra questions to, you know, just to review the chapter. But you will not write the question answers in the copy, but you will keep the document safely with you, or you can use it to prepare your notes, and that can help you to understand this chapter more, in a more better way. Yes. Now next topic is types or the kinds of forces. This topic you have covered in previous classes also, that there are two kinds of forces. What are those two kinds of forces? Contact forces and non-contact forces. And they are very easy to understand, as when I say contact force means there is direct touch between the two objects or two interacting objects. But when I say non-contact force means the objects are not in touch with each other and still they are applying or they are exerting force on one another. Let us understand them in detail. In contact force, the force which are applied on the bodies by making a physical contact with them are called contact force. Let us take an example for this. I have kept this pen on the book. Do you think this pen can move on his own? Or if I want to push the pen, can I apply the force from this distance? So it means that there is no touch between the two objects. What are the two objects here? Pen and the finger. So in this case, where mechanical force I am applying, I have to touch the pen. I am touching the pen and then only the pen is moving. Yes. So such type of forces are called contact forces. These contact forces are further categorized as force of friction, normal reaction, force of tension, then force exerted by the spring, and force of collision. So you might be asked in the exam, give us two types of contact force, or some example will be given to you and you will be asked to identify what kind of contact force is present in it. Okay, so we will be discussing now such questions. Okay, so the first part is frictional force. All of you know that frictional force is a force which acts on the object in the opposite direction. If my object is moving in this direction, what is the direction of frictional force? Opposite. Yeah, that is this direction. Pen is moving towards east. What is the direction of frictional force? West. Yes. So frictional force is also called as opposing force because it acts in the opposite direction to the direction of motion. Yes. So keep on underlining all these important points. You might be asked a question in the exam that by looking at a particular figure, identify the direction of friction. Now look here, the push is it towards east direction, or you can say towards right. Yes. So what will be the direction of force of friction? Force of friction will be towards left. Now you should not draw the force of friction, you know, at this level, or means you, it should be along the surface. This point you have to take care of, this thing, that even if I am drawing the force of friction here, it should be in touch with the surface. You have learned in your previous classes that friction is exerted on the object when the object is in touch with the surface. So when we say it is in touch with the surface, means the friction is along this surface, not above, or it in the empty space. It is not in the empty space. Now let us move on to the next concept. Next type of force is normal reaction. Children, normal means perpendicularly. So this force and reaction means a force which is in response to some action. I hope you have learned about action and reaction in previous classes. So reaction means, you know, a response due to some action. Now let us understand this, where we can observe this force. Look, there is a palm, or you can say a table is there. On the table you have kept a block. Now you know that on that block the downward force, or you can say gravitational force, is acting on it. Here I am writing gravitational force. We all know that the direction of gravitational force is downward. So do you think this box or this block will move towards the earth? Means it is kept on the table and it will, you know, break the table, and through the table, or making a hole in the table, it will get towards the earth. It doesn't happen. Yes, you keep your books on the table, and we all know that the gravitational pull is acting on those books all the time, but those book does not move towards or fall towards the earth. Why it happens so? It is due to an upward force which is acting on the box, and that upward force is perpendicularly to the surface. Or you can say that this upward force is the reaction of this action. So action here is gravitational force. In reaction, table or this palm exert force on the block. So this reaction force we are calling as normal reaction force, because this force is perpendicular to the surface, and this enables the objects to remain at fixed position. Yes, otherwise the things will fall towards the gravitational force. Yes, so you can underline the examples and the definition for this normal reaction force. Let us move on to the next force, that is tension force as applied through the string. Now where do we observe this tension force? We observe the tension force when something is hanging with the string. Yes, when you look closely at this object, this block is hanging with the string. Now again, the same thing. On this block, gravitational force is acting downward, but this block does not move towards the earth. Who is responsible in holding the block at one position? Yes, this force, that is the tension in the string, or tension is along the thread or the string which is tied here to this top. Yes, or the rigid support is there. So this tension force is there with the block, and it is making a direct contact. This thread along which the tension force is exerting is in direct touch with the string. So if I ask you a question, tension force is a contact force. Give reason. What will be our answer? Tension force is a contact force because try to think of the definition of contact force. Yes, while attempting the answer. Tension force is a contact force because it can act on an object only when it is in touch with the object. Yes, this force can act on an object only when it is in contact with the object which is hanging. I hope you should use this question for other forces also and try to find out the answer for it. And you will find similar questions in my document which I am sending along with this. Next type of force is force exerted by a spring. Now here the spring, when you want to compress or stretch the spring, what happened? After removing the applied force, this pull here, which is shown here, is the applied force. When you remove the applied force, what happened? That the spring tried to come back to its original shape. Yes. Why it happens? Because the spring exerts a restoring force in it. Restoring. Restoring force, you can think about its meaning, that something which regains or restore itself. Okay, it tried to come back to the original shape and size. So spring has ability to come back to its original shape and size because of this force, restoring force. And restoring force is in direct touch with the object. And here this is the answer to 4B. I hope you are underlining and marking the question number. Now another type of contact force is force of collision. Force of collision happens when any two objects collide with each other. Say one ball A and another ball B, they are coming towards each other. And they exert push on or pull on each other. That type of force is collision force. Obviously, for collision to happen, the objects have to come in touch with each other. And therefore, this type of force is a contact force. Yes. So, you should, go through the diagrams. You might be asked in the exam that draw the direction of forces when the two objects are colliding with each other. So these directions you have to carefully note down, that FAB. FAB means force on A, that is this ball due to B. And what will be FBA? This direction. Force on B due to A. Yes? Now, the next type of forces are non-contact force. I have already given you the hint that non-contact forces where the objects are not in touch with each other. For example, this pen is here. Okay. And or you can consider that this pen is an iron nail. Yes. This is an iron nail. Consider this as an iron nail. And this cap, black color cap, is a magnet. Yes. If I bring this magnet near to the iron nail, what will happen? The iron nail will try to get attracted towards the magnet. Yes or no? So do you think that this magnet has applied force on the object from a certain distance? Yes. Or if I want this iron nail to get attracted towards magnet, I have to touch the magnet. Do you think I have to touch the magnet for this iron? I have to touch the iron nail for this iron nail to get in touch with the magnet. Yes. Yes. This is our common observation, that whenever a magnet is there and the iron nail is there, there is no need to bring this magnet in touch with the iron nail. You can keep the magnet at a certain distance, and without any physical touch, the magnet can exert its force, and such forces are called non-contact force. Yes, through this activity, I hope the concept of non-contact forces is clear to you, that in the non-contact forces, the force, the object which is exerting force should not be in touch with the iron nail, or should not be in touch with the object. From a certain distance also, the objects can exert the force. So such forces are gravitational force. You can underline the definition of gravitational force. Then there is one more term, force of gravity, or the weight of the object. Whatever force of attraction is exerted by earth, in particularly earth, on any object on the earth is called gravity, or force of gravity. Even it is also called weight. And these are the few examples of gravitational force. You should think about the answer to the question, why do we call gravitational force a non-contact force? Yes, I'm giving you the hint that try to use the definition of non-contact force here. Yes. Next is electrostatic force. This is the force of attraction between the similar or unlike charges, even when they are at a certain distance. There is a very simple activity which you have seen in your previous classes, where we rub the comb on the dry hair and it attracts the bits of paper. Yes, so that comb, if this is a comb, red pen is a comb and black pen is the bits of paper, and the comb is kept at a certain distance. Yes, no physical touch or no physical contact between the two objects, and still the bits of paper get attracted towards the comb. Yes, so we can say that electrostatic force is a non-contact force. Just now we discussed about the magnetic forces, that the magnetic forces is the force between the magnetic poles is called magnetic force, and it also acts from a certain distance. Therefore, it is a non-contact force. Now, these are the two another main points. Here you can mark a question, or you know, use any symbol. Question might be asked in the exam. Now, listen to my question for this. Question is, what is the difference between gravitational force and electrostatic or magnetic force? Okay, so in the case of gravitational force, only attractive force is observed, whereas in the case of magnetic and electrostatic force, both the nature of the force is attractive as well as repulsive. Why we say attractive? In case of electrostatic force, we have like opposite charges attract and same charges repel. In magnetic forces also, we have same poles, they repel and opposite force attract. Yes, and because of that, the forces have both kind of nature. Another important question is that in case of non-contact force, all the forces, they are actually depending upon the distance, and there is inverse relationship between the force and the distance. You can write down this expression. This is non-contact force. I'm writing down here N is inversely proportional to the square of the distance. This is the relation of non-contact force with the distance. So what do we observe? As the distance between the object increases, if distance increases, what happened to the force? If distance increases, force decreases. Inverse relationship is here. So here it is written, it decreases with the increase in separation, or increases as the separation decreases. You can imagine that the object which is going away from the earth, or the space between the earth and the object is more, So what happened to the gravitational force? It decreases. What happened to the non-contact force? It decreases. I hope these points are clear to you, and try to use these concepts in solving the questions given in the document. And for your homework, we will be completing exercise 3.A. All the answers I have marked on the book itself. Thank you for today.